evening and a very warm welcome to University College Isle of Man and to this evening's lecture. I'm delighted to welcome Leah Jameson to speak with us this evening. Leah's recently returned to the Isle of Man, having spent a number of years in Manchester studying for an undergraduate and postgraduate degree in history. Her main area of interest is the Arab-Israeli conflict, and she's going to talk to us this evening about research that she undertook for her master's degree, examining Jewish immigration to Britain and Palestine during the 1930s and 40s. So, very warm welcome to you.
Thank you very much. Hi everyone, thanks for coming this evening. As Katrina said, my name's Leah. For my master's dissertation, I looked into British immigration policies in the 1930s and the 1940s, comparing policies of the Home Office, the Colonial and the Foreign Offices, and the change in attitudes within the government. During the 1930s, immigration became a key concern for Whitehall and the British government due to changes within Germany, which I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with. And it became a focal point, so you'll see how different events around the globe actually came to impact one specific area of policy making within one specific government, which ultimately contributed to the downfall of the British mandate. Now, just to give you a quick overview. Do you want me to speak up? Sorry, I should have asked if everyone could hear me. I'll try and speak up. I might have to take a few sips of water during the course of it. But yes, Germany in the 1930s, we have here a central player in changes to immigration policies and the increase in demand for Jewish immigration. So on the 30th of January 1933, Adolf Hitler became the Chancellor of Germany. This put him in a political position to remove his political rivalries, and he was a notorious anti-Semite, which means that he was very against the Jewish people as a race. However, a lack of foresight meant that most people thought that the anti-Semitic tide would recede, and this contributed in relatively low immigration numbers. Then in 1935, the Nuremberg Laws were introduced. Now, these stripped Jews of citizenship and capital, and also forbade marriage and sexual relations between Jews and non-Jews. So this, in effect, legalised anti-Semitism and increased the number of Jews who wished to leave Germany. However, at the time, their loss of capital made them less attractive to prospective countries of refuge. Then in 1936, there was the reform of the Reichsflight tax. Now, this did take revenue from non-Jews and Jews. However, this built on the Nuremberg Laws, which ultimately meant that the Jews wishing to leave Germany were put in an even worse position financially, which further impacted their ability to emigrate. 1938 was the key year for Germany. They had territorial expansion in the Anschluss, which is the annexation of Austria, and this incorporated another 180,000 Jews into the German sphere of influence. You also had the annexation of the Czechoslovak Sudetenland, and with the territorial expansion came the expansion of anti-Semitism. And this culminated in November of 1938 in what became known as Kristallnacht. Now, this translates to the Night of Broken Glass and was a direct attack on Jewish citizens and property and resulted in deaths, imprisonment, and also ultimately increased the number of Jews wishing to leave. So unsurprisingly then, the pressure for immigration throughout the 1930s continued to increase with all these changes in Germany. Now, we'll turn to Britain. So on the 7th of April 1933, there was a Home Office memorandum titled "The Present Position in Regard to the Admission of Jewish Refugees from Germany to This Country." Not the snappiest of titles, but this basically set out policies which would continue up until 1938. So in this, temporary visits were allowed before what was assumed to be resettlement elsewhere. Now, these visits would usually last around a month, or that was what the government hoped, which meant that these immigrants would not be a permanent burden as they were seen to the government. Employment was also strictly forbidden, and economic self-sufficiency was necessary. So these basic principles laid out in 1933 when anti-Semitism was actually relatively low, continued throughout the 30s, but actually the policy remained relatively flexible, which gave the government a lot of room to manoeuvre. So with the increase of the Third Reich's power, as well as anti-Semitic violence, a policy of pre-selection was adopted. Now, this was a strict criteria limiting who could and couldn't come into the country. And on top of this, those temporary visits, which I mentioned earlier, were also to be pre-selected abroad. Now, this change came to reflect rising local anti-Semitism within the country because of increasing numbers of Jews which were coming into Britain. So this extract here from the Daily Mail says how there are obvious objections to a policy of indiscriminate admission. Such an influx of aliens would compete seriously with our own people in the labour market, and in a time of national emergency, they would be an additional burden on our resources. So you can see here, I'm sure, probably comparisons to newspaper articles even from today, which we will touch upon later on. Now, we will move to Palestine during the same era. For those of you that are less familiar, I've provided here a definition of Zionism. Now, Zionism was a political movement which was originally for the re-establishment and what is now the development and protection of a Jewish nation and what we know as Israel, but was at the time of the period that my dissertation looked at, it was known as Palestine. Now, this started in 1897 and began by Theodor Herzl in response to anti-Semitic pogroms in Eastern Europe and Russia. So this, the forefront of Zionism, like I said, was the development of the development of the Jewish nation and a Jewish home. So this was known as the Yishuv and became imperative throughout the 1930s when European Jewry was threatened. Going back now to April of 1933, we have the Committees on Aliens Restrictions Report. And again here, it was outlined how Jewish immigration was basically unwanted. And in it, it said, there is no reason to suppose that room could be found in Palestine in the near future for any appreciable number of German Jewish refugees. Now, sorry, just a quick water break. Now, this was a threat to the Yishuv and the Zionist ambition within Palestine. However, growing Arab unrest meant that the British authorities within Palestine had to be seen to act. The Arab community within Palestine had actually been battling Zionism since the increase of the Jewish population there, because they felt that their national interests were at threat. And with this, it culminated in what became known as the Arab Revolt, which broke out in 1936 in a direct protest against the ongoing Jewish immigration. In response, the British authorities actually feared condemnation from Zionist sympathisers. So they sent the Palestine Royal Commission, known as the Peel Commission, to Palestine to investigate grievances of the Arab and Jewish community. The report was published in July of 1937. And the main outcome was the recommendation of petition. They saw this, as it says here, as the only method we are able to propose for dealing with the root of the trouble. Now, this was the petition into two separate states. So the Arab state would be the orange-yellow colour on the map, and the green area would be the Jewish state, and Britain would maintain control of the holy places, which are shown there in red. Now, immigration was also to be determined on the economic absorptive capacity of the country, which basically meant that they didn't want so many immigrants coming in that those already within the country would be economically disadvantaged on its very, very basic level. However, the report ended up being rejected by the Jews and the Arabs, as well as some within Whitehall. The Foreign Office in particular maintained how the Palestine was a key strategic area in the Middle East, and one which, with the growing likelihood of war, Britain did not want to risk any outbreak of conflict in the area, as it could potentially mean them having a war on two fronts. So by 1938, you can see that both in Britain and in Palestine, local events actually had a big influence on policy decisions. So domestically in Britain, you had the growth of anti-Semitism encouraging the closing of borders. And in Palestine, you had the Arab revolt, again, encouraging restrictions against Jewish immigrants, which ultimately impacted the ability of Jews to escape an increasingly hostile regime. So 1938 then, this saw the Evian Conference take place in July. Now, this was called by US President Roosevelt, and it was the first major attempt of an international network to help alleviate the growing refugee crisis within Europe. However, during this conference, it became apparent that Britain was very unwilling to acquiesce on their policies. And in terms of Britain, they said that the United Kingdom is not a country of immigration. They said this because they didn't want any international involvement in what they considered British policymaking. Then we come to Palestine. Now, this was actually only referenced once on the very final day of the conference. So the British representatives there were largely elusive on the issue. And they basically just said, Palestine cannot usefully be taken into account at the present stage in connection with the general problems that are under consideration. Now, this again was Britain trying to block any international involvement in their policy decisions. And they were very reluctant to open their borders because of the issues that we have already mentioned. However, the Evian Conference, although it turned out to be a bit of a failure in terms of encouraging any change, it did actually signal the first international gathering which tried to resolve the Jewish refugee problem within Europe. So this marked a key moment in 1938, and come 1939, you had another major breakthrough. Now, this came in the form of the MacDonald White Paper, and this was published in response to the Arab unrest and marked a major turning point in Palestine. So the White Paper outlined that they would admit 25,000 Jews as a contribution towards alleviating the refugee crisis. However, after this, there would be a cap of 10,000 Jews per year for a total of 5 years, after which any further immigration would rely on Arab consent. So this was a total of 75,000 Jews over 5 years. In addition, there would be restriction on Jewish land sales, which, alongside immigration, were the biggest cause for Arab unrest and upset. And the High Commissioner would also continue to assess the economic situation within the country. So these terms could actually be amended depending on how the High Commissioner saw fit. Now, this final point was also key in terms of Britain no longer being under any obligation to facilitate the further development of the Jewish national home. Now, this was the first major policy reversal since the 1917 Balfour Declaration, which promised Jews a national home in Palestine following the First World War. And from this, the seeds were basically sown for the downfall of the mandate, because it marked the first major clash in British promises to the Jews and the Arabs. So hopefully then, in the 1930s, you've been able to see how there's the comparative history of Britain and Palestine with regards immigration policies has shown one of a progressively restrictive path, with British interests and national security being at the heart. Immigration was seen as one such way to secure British interests. So in terms of Britain, you had reserving resources and avoiding any anti-immigrant and specifically anti-Semitic sentiment. And then in Palestine, you had the appeasement of the Arabs in order to avoid a war on two fronts and also to preserve the British imperial interests which were in the region. So we move now to the war years. And in response to the 1939 White Paper, the Zionist community within Palestine upped their efforts for the Aliyah Bet movement. Now, this translates to the organised illegal immigration of Jews into Palestine. So the efforts, as I've said, increased after the White Paper as a direct attack on British authority there. So this man pictured here is David Ben-Gurion, which some of you may or may not have heard of. He was an ardent Zionist and would become Israel's first prime minister, and he was really important within the Zionist movement. So in 1941, he was quoted saying how a direct attempt is now being made to separate the problem of Palestine from that of the Jews. This separation denies the content and destiny of Zionism and endangers our Jewish existence in Palestine, i.e. it dangers the development and continuation of the Jewish Yishuv. In 1943, he repeated this notion when Nazi atrocities could no longer be ignored, saying, if, God forbid, the remains of European Jewry will be destroyed, what will be the fate of the Yishuv? So you can see here how for Zionists, the White Paper cap on immigration was actually seen as a direct threat to their political goals and ambitions. And in response, the British, in response to this, ended up having quite negative feelings towards this clear and direct attempt to circumvent policies that they had implemented. And as in response, they implemented a ban on the White Paper quotas from 1939 to 1940, and this again was put into place in late 1940 to 1941. So the politicised agenda of Zionism also tainted the humanitarian aspect. And I've just got a quote here that I'll read out for you, which was a collaboration of the Home Colonial and Foreign Offices in a memorandum in January 1940. And they were quoted saying how Aliyah Bet was an organised invasion of Palestine for political motives, which exploits the facts of the refugee problem and unscrupulously uses the humanitarian appeal of the latter to justify itself. So they're basically saying how Zionism was using the anti-Semitism within Europe to further progress their political goals. Now, the mandate's response was that of blockade and internment. One such way they tried to do this was to prevent the embarkation of refugee ships from Europe. Now, these often failed because diplomatic efforts with countries were made. However, Jewish refugees were often leaving countries from which they were not actually legal citizens. So preventing them from leaving was a difficult task and had a lot of humanitarian questionability surrounding it. So as a further deterrent, therefore, camps were actually set up in places like Mauritius, Palestine, and Cyprus. And I have some pictures here for you, if you can see them up there. These were detention camps for what were classed as illegal immigrants. And it was decided that this was necessary in order to try and show the Arab community that the British were actually serious about reducing Jewish immigrant numbers. And this became even more important because the Axis offensive in North Africa actually threatened the Middle East directly. So the Brits, again, were concerned that war would break out in the Middle East as well. Now, these camps, although definitely not the same as Nazi concentration camps, you can see here, they were not intended to be comfortable. The idea of them was to try and deter further immigrants from coming into Palestine, therefore reducing Arab discontent whilst also reducing the need for Britain to react and place them in these camps. So yes, conditions, while humane, must not be comfortable. Which kind of, when you think about, when you now know with hindsight how bad it was in camps in Europe, it kind of, when you look at British history, it's a bit worrying that they would also do something similar, obviously on a much less extent. So yes, if we look now to immigration during the war in Britain. With the outbreak of war, immigration was banned from enemy territory. Germany had a lot of immediate victories at the start of the war, which meant that this came to cover much of mainland Europe and ultimately reduced Jewish escape from the continent. As well as this, there was necessary qualifications to still get into Britain, even if you reached neutral or allied ground. Now, personal value to the war effort was considered, and political grounds were also considered. So, for instance, if you were a communist, you would be granted entry. However, what was excluded was consideration on humanitarian and racial grounds, which, for the Jewish community especially, was actually central to their desire to leave Europe. During the same period, there was a continuing push for re-emigration. So this was those who had come for temporary settlement and were expected to then leave at some point in the future. Despite war circumstances, in 1940, 10,000 actually left Britain. However, historian Louise London, who has looked into Britain and immigration in particular, notes how, although they were actually labelled as voluntary, the circumstances surrounding them were often close to expulsion. And the near bankruptcy of British Jewry, who had been funding immigration of the Jews into Britain from the 1930s, when capital was taken off them from the Reich, they had become bankrupt just because of the sheer number of Jews they'd had to fund. So because of this, expenditure was then expected to come from the public pocket. And as I'm sure we're all aware, that's never a popular solution. So the risk of resulting anti-immigrant and anti-Semitic sentiments increased these points above. And again, there were further blockades against Jewish pathways to escape Germany. A key year during the war came in 1942. And this saw a change in domestic and mandatory policies. So in October 1941, there was legislative change in Germany, which forbade any authorised flight of Jews from Germany. This then culminated in the Wannsee Conference in January 1942. Now, this was held in Berlin by Reinhard Heydrich, which some of you may or may not have heard of. And this was the aim of this was to formalise what became known as the final solution to the Jewish question. After this conference, the physical and systematic extermination of what was estimated to be an 11 million European Jews accelerated for all of those still trapped under the Third Reich's grasp. And as a consequence, it was only after 1942 that those rumours and stories that had been heard about Nazi atrocities could no longer be ignored. And as a result, the United Nations Declaration, which came almost a year after the Wannsee Conference, was held. Now, this was broadcast from the House of Commons, and it denounced Nazi atrocities and also called for retribution. However, within the speech, the immense geographical and other difficulties in the matter were emphasised, other difficulties predominantly being the fact that there was a world war. Now, this admittance of the powerlessness of the Allied powers actually ignited a tirade of criticism. And the Manchester Guardian was one such newspaper which publicly denounced the Allies' lack of action before 1942. And in it, they declared how Palestine provides our greatest opportunity for rescue by Eastern Europe. However, by this point, off the war, escape was actually not feasible. As many of us will be aware, this was the beginning of the planned extermination. So this was when the ghettos were emptied, Jews from Western Europe were transported to the east for the physical extermination. So in response to the criticism of the inaction, another conference was held, this time in Bermuda, in April of 1943. Now, there were some concessions offered here, but because of the circumstance that America and Britain found themselves in, the outcome was almost inevitable in the fact that victory was seen as the only way to offer salvation for those still trapped within Europe. So unfortunately, the Allies, by this point, realised the only way they could actually help was to win the war. Another key event in 1942 was the sinking of the Struma. Now, this was a refugee ship which was carrying around 750 to 800 Jews, and they were destined for Palestine. The ship was held in quarantine after it broke down off the coast of Istanbul for a total of 2 months, and after failed diplomatic efforts between Turkey and Britain, the Turkish authorities towed the ship back out to sea. However, the ship was then what's thought to be have been accidentally hit by a Soviet torpedo, and all but one passenger was killed. So Britain's lack of action again became the focus of criticism. And the Manchester Guardian, again, can be seen in the quote up on the screen to be one such paper which condemned the government. They condemned the government's actions off the mandate as being contrary to the interests of the Jews to whom established British policy had promised the national home, making a direct reference to the Balfour Declaration I touched upon very briefly earlier. So, and in Palestine, again in response to the sink of the Struma, you had this poster here which pictured the High Commissioner, Sir Harold McMichael. Now, this is a wanted for murder poster which was published by the Jewish Defence Organisation known as the IRGUM, who ultimately blamed Britain for the deaths of the 750 to 800 Jews on board. Although there was criticism, there was support for Whitehall, who continued to believe that Palestine did not answer the complete refugee crisis. However, although the colonial and foreign officers were reluctant to actually acquiesce, pressure from the British public, as well as some Zionist supporters within the British government and the United States pushed for policy revisions. So in May 1942, those who reached Palestine were granted an immediate certificate through the White Paper and were allowed to stay. Then in June of 1943, the ban on immigration from enemy territory was lifted. However, these came at a time when escape from the Third Reich was all but impossible because of the systematic slaughter known as the Holocaust, which will become known as the Holocaust. So although this period did see some relaxations, Whitehall were actually unable to offer much to alleviate the sufferings of those Jews still trapped. So concessions were almost empty gestures in a way, because these concessions came at a time when those who were reluctant to acquiesce could be convinced by the fact that immigration numbers would remain significantly lower than they had been before the war. And historian Louise London eloquently summarised this, stating how that Whitehall's aim was to reduce public pressure for action and avoid criticism for inaction. So again, the empty gestures were put into place just to quieten the public. We move now to the post-war, or the late war and post-war years, where we come full circle and we actually see policies again turning to a policy of restriction. Germany was in retreat by the early to mid-1940s, so freedom to travel and those immigration routes were reopened, which again reignited apprehensions regarding a flood of immigrants. So in Palestine then, on the 31st of March of 1944, Jewish immigration was able to continue, but only up until all white paper certificates had been exhausted. And by the end of the war, there were actually less than 11,000 remaining. And when you look at the extent of Nazi atrocities and how many were actually lucky to survive, 11,000 doesn't really go very far. Deportation schemes were also reconsidered, wherein those reaching Palestine would be sent back to where they embarked. And Jews reaching Turkey were no longer actually granted automatic access into Palestine. Then we move to Britain. Now, although with the Labour victory in 1945, there was growing acceptance for a policy of absorption and naturalisation for those already in the country, Whitehall did go on to announce the Distressed Persons Scheme of November 1945, which ultimately echoed sentiments which were introduced in the early 1930s. So again, you'd have selectivity abroad. Those Jews who were successful would have to have a proof of maintenance and accommodation to actually be granted entry. There would again be time limits, and future resettlement elsewhere was expected. Employment this time was not completely forbidden, but was only available for those who would be seen to fill the labour shortage after the war. And this scheme was to be continually reassessed to ensure national interests. So in both Palestine and Britain, national self-interest again was pushed to the forefront, given the destitute situation that Britain found itself in following the Second World War. So Palestine and Europe now. Britain had strove to keep these two areas separate. However, after the war, these inevitably became entwined. So international collaboration increased after the war, which was a significant change, one of the most significant changes in this period. The United Nations was established on the 24th of October of 1945, which epitomised this. The displaced persons, or DP crisis, then became an international concern. So whereas before, countries such as Britain had been able to prevent involvement in their policies, now you had this international collaboration come together, and it wasn't quite so easy to get around. The Anglo-American Committee of Inquiry, which was set up in January of 1946, was the peak of this international collaboration. Now, this was America and Britain coming together to investigate Palestine and Europe and how the DP crisis could be resolved. On the 20th of April, Truman announced this report, despite Britain not being happy with the final report. And in it, he said that he believed how Palestine would offer the greatest relief for the DP crisis. Now, this came because there was a spurt in Jewish support for the Zionist cause with those survivors in Europe. And alongside Truman's firm belief that Palestine offered the answer, he also called for the immediate release of 100,000 certificates. So whereas before we only had 11,000 certificates remaining for the white paper, Truman was then calling for 100,000. This obviously gained a lot of popularity amongst the Jewish population within Palestine and, importantly, America, whilst irreparably damaging Britain's authority. This public announcement also officially bound Europe and Palestine, which would become very important with regards to Britain's withdrawal from the mandate. In response to this, Britain did try to gain re-standing. So the July 1946 Morrison-Grady plan was published. This was another attempt to split Palestine into two separate regions. So you'd have one Jewish and one Arab province, and then Britain would continue to administer on a trusteeship basis until the two states were able to collaborate, and Britain would then be able to completely withdraw. This, however, was not only rejected by the United States, who wanted a much quicker solution to the issue, but it was also rejected by the Arabs, who did not believe that Palestine was up for negotiation. In addition to this, the Jews knew that they had America's support, and they too outright rejected the plan. So the overpowering influence of the United States came in after the Second World War, because Britain, who was in a much worse position, particularly financially, relied on the United States, who become a big player in the post-war world. And this overpowering influence of the United States damaged Whitehall's ability to be able to act independently and autonomously. So their policies were no longer to be decided solely by Whitehall. In the post-war world as well, we had an increase of terrorism and the acceleration of the Aliyah Bet, or illegal immigration movement. So this came amidst these international changes. And Jewish terrorism had been ongoing. However, after the war, with the realisation of the true extent of Nazi atrocities, this really picked up and directly attacked British administration. So the Mandate's ability to tackle terrorist circles was greatly reduced after the war because of the damage the war had done. And militarily, they could not dedicate enough men to the area, given the occupation zones that they still had to administer in Europe. So the most highly notorious attack was the King David Hotel, which came about on the 22nd of July 1946 and took place, was organised by the Irgun, who I mentioned earlier, who released that wanted for murder poster. And they were acting on behalf of the Jewish United Resistance Movement, which was a collaboration of Jewish organisations which were trying to fight against British rule in Palestine. This ended up killing more than 90 people, including British, Arabs and Jews. And in response, there was a call for repressive measures. These calls were unanswerable because the Mandate was already in a position where it was struggling to reel back control. On top of this, you had the acceleration of Aliyah Bet, with over 50,000 Jews coming into Palestine from 1945 to 1948. So although the Mandate tried to, again, prevent ships from reaching Palestine, many European governments, given the extent of Nazi atrocities, were even more reluctant to assist, just because of the humanitarian issues this would have raised. So the US government was also a heavy critic of the Mandate's continued attempts to block Jewish entry into Palestine. Again, one of the most notorious events to do with Aliyah Bet was the Exodus affair in July of 1947. Now, the Exodus was carrying 4,500 Jews from France to Palestine. On arrival, though, the British had a struggle with those passengers because they wished to put them onto three separate vessels to send them back to Europe. Three actually lost their life in the struggle, and many more were injured. However, the British were successful, but once they reached France, the French authorities were reluctant to force the passengers to disembark. So they actually sat off the coast for 3 weeks, after which the British were forced to accept them into their occupation zone within Europe. So not only did they then become an extra burden, so to speak, for the British in Europe, but this also raised criticism and outrage because these Jews who had just left camps were then put back into camps within the occupation zone until permanent resettlement elsewhere could be sought. So both of these factors, as well as the rise of the US on the international scene, both helped to destabilise the Mandate, which leads us then to withdrawal. So an already exhausted Britain was really struggling by 1947. Not only was it losing men and money within Palestine, trying to reduce these terrorist circles, but it was also stretched in Europe in the occupation zones, as well as domestically having to try and rebuild society. So, sorry, I've lost where I am. So yes, all of these factors, encouraged Britain to surrender the Mandate to the United Nations. And the United Nations Special Committee on Palestine, known as UNSCOP, was established. Now, this visited Palestine and Europe in the summer of 1947. It eventually came to a recommendation which we are familiar with, which was partition of Palestine. So this time, the Arab area would consist of the yellowy-orange colour, and the Jewish state would consist of this bluey-green colour. So the Jewish state would be around 56%, and the Arab state around 44%. Now, this was in spite of the Arab population being almost double that of the Jews. So the vote for this plan was passed by 33 votes in favour to 13 rejections, and there were 10 abstentions, including Great Britain, who wanted to try and remain neutral. So after the announcement that the report, that the petition plan was had been successful, there was violent outbursts within Palestine. So the ungovernability of the area then worsened and became more severe. And on top of the other constraints Britain was feeling, they decided to withdraw. So on the 14th of May 1948, the final High Commissioner, Sir Alan Cunningham, left Haifa, and on that same day, the State of Israel was declared, which ignited what has since been an ongoing conflict. So the ungovernability of the mandate and the failed UN resolution took place within the broader international and British context. So post-war immigration concerns were important in encouraging the surrender of the mandate. And events in Palestine not only began to really impact the mandate, but it also began to impact the British at home. And the mandate was becoming more and more unpopular because of the drain on resources and the loss of life of British military personnel after what had already been an extremely devastating war. So to give you a quick overview and recap, the supersession of humanitarian concerns took place because of national self-interest. And there was, although the home colonial and foreign officers were all acting in order to satisfy the demands of their specific departments, there were overriding contextual influences which can be seen to be important for all three. So the 1930s, the period here was summarised by the European volatility and the likelihood of war. So domestically, reducing immigration centred on the ongoing economic slump, as well as fears of growing anti-Semitism. Within Palestine, there was a booming economy because of the Yishuv and the Jewish community there. So the economy was not such an important factor here. Rather, the Jewish plight was actually relegated here in favour of Arab appeasement in order to avoid a war on two fronts. Now, the precedent was set during this time for the supersession of humanitarian concerns, and this continued throughout the war years into the 1940s. So with the beginning of war, up until 1945, the overriding concern here was, of course, national security and the Allied victory. And pressures on the war influenced domestic policies both in Britain and Palestine. Domestically, then, you had strains on resources and the desire to close British borders, push for greater strategies for re-immigration and pre-selection abroad. Now you turn to Palestine, and the relations with the Arabs continue to be of vital importance in terms of avoiding a war on two fronts, particularly with the Axis offensive in North Africa. Although 1942 did offer some concessions from the home, foreign and colonial officers, these came too late and came at a time when escape from Europe was all but impossible. And then you look to 1945 to 1948. And here the internationalism and the New World Order, as well as Britain's damaged reputation and damaged authority, epitomised this period. Domestically then, the main concern from the Home Office was post-war recovery during an economic slump. And this, of course, made refugees unattractive from a resource perspective, but also because of the hostility this could ignite. In Palestine, the suppression of the Aliyeh Bet and terrorist movements was seen as paramount in regaining control of the mandate. And again, Anglo-Arab relations were pushed to the forefront because with the Cold War, the Middle East again became a centre of strategic importance. So although post-war immigration policies continued to be regarded alongside national interests, the change in global climate actually meant that immigration became an international concern. And this inhibited Britain's ability to make unilateral decisions. So reliance on the US, a loss of international standing, and the issues seen within Palestine in terms of terrorism and illegal immigrants, as well as the growing hostility towards the mandate within Britain, encouraged Whitehall to surrender the Palestine question to the United Nations. So as a result, Jews actually fell victim to Britain's self-serving pragmatism. And the effects of immigration became central to policy decisions throughout the period discussed. Again, the withdrawal of Britain was actually in favour of British interests. So there was actually no change in their withdrawal. However, what was I saying? I've forgotten now. So yeah, sorry. Britain continued to put its national interests to the front, even with the withdrawal from the mandate. And events outside of Palestine proved to be continuously just as important in influencing this decision. And that demonstrated how seemingly separate affairs ultimately became entwined and impacted one of the largest decisions of the era. So to finish now, I just want to leave you on a thought. I'm no expert on modern day immigration policies and refugee crises, but you may have seen some familiar notions there that you might be able to recognise in today's newspapers, on today's news channels. So in recent years, we've actually seen the revival of far-right political views. In Britain, you have UKIP. In France, you have the National Front. In Denmark, you have the Danish People's Party. Then you look at the rise of Donald Trump and his desire to block out the Mexicans by building a wall. You look at the vote in favour of Brexit and the desire here to reduce the number of EU migrants crossing the border. Even in Germany, there's been a spike in neo-Nazism and far-right political views. This was especially in response to Germany's actually commendable response to the Syrian refugee crisis. So although anti-immigrant views don't always necessarily arise from from refugee crises, it's often the fact that refugee crises affect such a sheer number of people that anti-immigrant and anti-refugee sentiments are sparked. So if you think of Syria and ISIS, if you think of Myanmar and the Rohingya Muslims, look at Nigeria and Boko Haram. The scale of those affected often drives national self-interest and the desire to prevent immigration, because governments don't want to risk a too open a policy for fears of domestic unrest. So the fine line between the political and human aspect has to be considered, because of course it's not possible for countries to take in all asylum seekers. Infrastructure wouldn't be able to cope, for instance. The labour market wouldn't be able to take in and accommodate all these people, and housing would become inadequate, and the list could go on. But the fact remains that countries, their governments and their citizens can still actually be seen repeating concerns that you can see quoted here off the 1930s and 40s. So you have to ask, really, how far have we actually come as an international community in answering the cries of those most in need? So that's the end. So thank you all for listening.